We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Good tidings we bring to you and your kin. We wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Praise the Lord, saints. Praise the Lord, saints. Put your hands together and praise the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I'm Minister Coleman, and I'd like to welcome you back again to the Christian's Endeavor YouTube station. Today, we're going to be discussing our Sunday School International Lesson dated for December the 19th, 2021. We do have a very inspiring lesson today, so I pray that you will enjoy the content that we're going to be providing and that it will be used to strengthen, encourage, and enrich you and prepare you for your upcoming Sunday school lesson, perhaps that you're going to partake in on this coming Sunday. Well, I personally want to wish you a Merry Christmas and a blessed and happy new upcoming year 2022. I thank God that you and I are looking forward to making it over. And I pray that God's graces will continue to be upon you. Our lesson for today, the topic, justice and righteousness. Justice and righteousness. The scriptural context. We're going to be coming today out of the book, the prophecy, book of Isaiah. And the chapter of focus is chapter 9. And we're actually going to be dealing with just the first 7 verses of chapter 9. Amen. Although our lesson starts off at the second verse. But we are also going to include that first verse, which is actually a continuation of the 8th chapter and the 21st through the 22nd verse. But we're not going to read that. But again, we have it's a two-part lesson. We're going to discuss God's judgment against Judah. Amen. The tribe, the people of God of the southern kingdom, Judah. But we're going to end in hope. We're going to end with a word of encouragement. We're going to end in a celebration of what is prophesied to come. Amen. So we do have a good lesson today. Let me go on ahead and I'll read our key verse of the lesson. Of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end. Upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. Amen. And that is again the 7th verse of the 9th chapter of Isaiah. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you in advance for sharing in this lesson with us. Father God, we pray that your spirit abide and that the hearer, Lord, will hear what thus saith the Lord. We pray, Lord, that you will anoint the servant to be able to share this lesson with articulation of speech and with understanding of thought, make it clear, break it down, so that your people will understand and take away from this lesson and apply all that needs to be applied to their lives. Make it effective, God. Father God, we thank you again for all of the hearers, all of the viewers of this station. And God, we pray that you will especially bless them because they seek to hear the word of God. Father God, we pray that you would supply their need, whatever they're seeking you for. We pray that you will supply, encourage your people. But moreover, God, we pray that we would get out of this lesson, the lesson of being obedient and faithful to you. Amen. So that we can avoid a lot of the judgment that can come against us. So let us also heed to that message, God, as we extract from the principles of this lesson today. God, again, bless this lesson and bless your hearers and bless the viewers all over the world and bless churches and people of God and pastors and ministers and missionaries, God, that has taken this word forth to encourage people all over the world. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I'm going to read our lesson text out of the King James Version. And then I'll follow up for sake of clarity. I'm going to read another version from the Good News Bible. Amen. But then as we break down the text and extract whatever we need to extract, I'm going to go back to that King James Version because that is the context of the standard international booklet that I have. Amen. You would know, like I would know, that it would do us due diligence to go and research some other versions of the Bible, because at times, just like we will see in our lesson today, that there is written some of the context in poetry. It involves poetry. It involves what does he say? It involves like a descriptive qualities that are given to things that would normally not possess outward qualities. And a lot of times those qualities are given to describe God. Amen. Whereas no one has ever seen God, but we give descriptive qualities such as God being a lawyer. Anybody ever seen him being a lawyer with a suitcase? Amen. Pacing the floors in the courtroom? No, we haven't seen that, but we give him the title of God being a judge. He's a lawyer. Amen. He knows law and especially his law. Amen. So we'll find some of these attributes or descriptive qualities given to describe Jesus. Amen. Who is prophesied to be the coming king. Amen. Can we keep it at that? So as we look into our text today for this call, sometimes it's just easier to go back and to research and just get that more clearer understanding from a different version, as long as that version certainly is true. But we do our research and we put things together so that we can make it clearer. Hey, if you get a lesson that you cannot understand, then that lesson is not going to profit you much. Amen. The Bible says, in all of our getting, get an understanding. Because when you get that understanding, you're more likely to apply that which you have been taught. Amen. Sometimes we can have a lot of knowledge, but if we don't truly understand the depth and the spiritual sense of that knowledge, we're not going to apply it. And that's what you see in a lot of saints and a lot of folk that go to church all the time. They constantly getting, but they have a lot of knowledge and it puffs them up because they feel like they have attained what they need to attain. But you won't know that they really know unless they are doing what they say they know. Amen. Amen. So it's all about the doing. That is the checkpoint. God does not want us to hear, but he wants us to do, amen, that which he has instructed us through our hearing, amen. So the text, let me go on ahead and read. And for sake of, again, our lesson, it starts, it says our scriptural text is from the first verse, but I'm going to start reading from the second verse because that's what's outlined in the Standard International Lesson. The people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them have the light shined. Thou hast multiplied the nation and hath increased the joy. They joy before thee according to the joy in harvest, and as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For thou hast broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian. For every battle of the warrior is with confused noise and garments rolled in blood. But this shall be with burning and fuel of fire. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And of increase of his government and peace there shall be no end, upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. Now that is our King James Version. I'm going to quickly read it again in the Good News Bible, beginning with verse 2. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. They lived in a land of shadows, but now light is shining on them. You have given them great joy, Lord. You have made them happy. They rejoice in what you have done. And as people rejoice when they harvest grain or when they divide captured wealth. For you have broken the yoke that burdened them and the rod that beat their shoulders. You have defeated the nation that oppressed and exploited your people, just as you defeated the army of Midian long ago. The boots of the invading army and all their blood-stained clothing will be destroyed by fire. A child is born to us. A son is given to us. And he will be our ruler. He will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. His royal power will continue to grow. His kingdom will always be at peace. He will rule as King David's successor, basing his powers on right and justice. And from now until the end of time, the Lord Almighty is determined to do all this. In Jesus' name, we say amen and amen. Glory to God. Is anybody excited? Amen? Amen. Well, this prophecy of good news in the latter part of our lesson today, it comes on the brink of some bad news as the prophet Isaiah, he wrote this book of Isaiah some 700 BC years, amen, BC, before Christ came on the scene, before Jesus came on the scene. Now, this wonderful book of prophecy is noted as the most prominent of the major prophets and of the minor prophets, because this book has more to say about the coming Messiah, amen. In the Old Testament, it prophesies the most about Jesus, the coming Messiah, the coming King, Emmanuel, which is God will soon be with us. So, even amongst all of the other prophets, the prophet Isaiah stands above them. Some of the key attributes that we relate to the prophet Isaiah. One was he was described as the eagle eye prophet. Why was he called the eagle eye prophet? He was called the eagle eye prophet because God had given him vision. God had given him vision, perhaps through dreams. God had given him vision through God's voice speaking to him. God had given him visions, perhaps through just visions. Amen. Amen. So he's called the eagle eye because in doing so, he was able to have that a keen sense of spiritual insight well into the future, as so he had seen Jesus coming on the scene as the coming King, as the coming Messiah, and prophesied to this some 700 years before Jesus even came, before he was even born. Here it was that Isaiah was speaking in this 8th century, amen, preceding the New Testament, amen, and preceding Jesus coming on the scene. This book of Isaiah has 66 books. Ironic, the Bible has 66 books. And guess what? I even noted just peculiarly how this book of Isaiah, the first portion of the book, ranging from chapters 1 through 39, more so speaks about the judgment and Isaiah warning the people to repent before destruction, amen. And then that latter part, 26, 27 chapters, would talk about the comfort, the hope, the promise of Jesus, amen. Almost like an Old Testament and a New Testament, because there was much judgment even when we look in the Old Testament, time after time, cycle after cycle, there was good, but then there was also a lot of judgment and justice of God, amen, where he would take out justice on the people. But when we get over to the 27 chapters of our New Testament, it talks more about the comfort and the hope that we should have and that is made available because Jesus is on the scene. That's just a little side note, amen, that ain't really got nothing to do with the breakdown of Isaiah, but I just noticed, amen, how peculiar was that, that it would have 66 books. He's noted as the most prominent prophet because he talks the most about Jesus coming on the scene. Isaiah, he was married to a prophetess. He had two sons. Some other things about Isaiah. Isaiah was not confident when God called and commissioned him to be a prophet. Amen. He talked much about he just was deeming himself to be an unclean, unfit, unable to speak what God would be telling him to speak. Amen. So he was like, go get somebody else. I'm not the man. Amen. I'm not the one. But God cleaned him up, used coal, touched his lips, purified him, sanctified him, consecrated him, and commissioned him to go forth. Amen. We need to take note of that, because oftentimes God gives us an assignment. He calls us to things, and truly we are unworthy, we are unfit to do the job. But if God called you, he will prepare you. Amen. Amen. He will give you exactly what you need to be able to do the job exactly the way that he wants it done. Amen. So we thank God for this example of how he prepared Isaiah to be used as a prophet unto his people, to the northern kingdom, Israel, the southern kingdom, Judah, and even to the surrounding nations, be it good or bad. Amen. Isaiah prophesied to them all. Amen. As so spoken and directed by God. Isaiah was truly the example of a visionary. He was able to see long into the future before things even occurred in the natural. We thank God for his prophecy. Amen. He prophesied under five kings before meeting his death. Amen. As a result of his works as a prophet. You know, a lot of times people are excited to see prophets come when they come and bearing good news and good prophecy about the future or confirming something that a person has in their heart. But when a disciple comes to fulfill their other duties, what are their other duties? Their other duties can consist of correcting people. It can consist of rendering judgment beforehand, warning people of maybe the doom that is to come if they do not change their ways. So a prophet is not all sweets, right? But there is some meat in the true message of a prophet that is coming with a word from God. And this was the case with Isaiah. He served underneath of the rulership of Ahaz, amen. And he had also served under Uzziah prior to Ahaz, and Jotham, amen. Then Ahaz, then Hezekiah, and lastly he served under Manasseh, and it was under Manasseh where he was executed as a prophet. And some even say the custom of the prophet's execution was to be sawed in half with a wood saw. Amen. So the Bible does not get very descriptive, I don't believe, in exactly how he died, but he was martyred. He was executed for the sake and the cause of Christ and the messages that aggrieved. Again, it started out well. He was saying all the good things if it was good for the people. But once he started talking about the gloom and the doom and the truth of God's judgment, then many people turned against him. Amen. And ultimately, this wicked king Manasseh would have him executed. So that is about all I think we're going to get into in regards to just a little background. But also setting the stage, I'll say this, that Isaiah came to prophesy and to give the people the warning of God's pending judgment. Judah, the pending judgment. Judgment for their sin, judgment for their rebellion, judgment for idolatry, and serving and consulting other things other than God. This was a turbulent time for Judah. The nation was in crisis. The nation was in unrest politically, socially, spiritually. Amen. And as a result of this spiritual unrest, this spiritual crisis, they had been plummeted into darkness, hopelessness, fear, amen, and helplessness. So this message of justice and righteousness, especially when it gets down to the the righteousness. God's getting ready to make things right through the coming of Jesus Christ being prophesied, amen, to come, is going to be a relief. It's going to be good news, amen. So this coincides again with our lesson, justice and righteousness. We got one more lesson on justice, amen, and then we're going to switch gears, amen. Our unit one theme centers around justice, law, and history. And so we got one more lesson on justice, and then we'll roll into, I believe, law is next. Amen. So let's get on into our lesson as we just go through it, breaking down and extracting from that King James text. Okay. All right. Y'all supposed to say all right. All right. All right. Amen. Or click the thumbs. It's right now. You need to be clicking the thumbs up button. Amen. To say amen with me. Praise the Lord. Amen. Verse 2. The people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, which is darkness, upon them hath the light shined. Now, these people, amen, is described not just as Jews, but also some Gentiles, amen, that are so looking for hope, amen, after this gloom and doom takeover of Syria or the Assyrians, amen, army. As a result of God using them to administer justice to Judah. This darkness. Now when we look and whenever we see the word darkness, because you got the contrast here in the same verse, darkness and light. And then you see shadow of death, which is also shadow of darkness. Whenever there is darkness, the spiritual is synonymous with death. Amen. Because where there is no light and or life, there's going to be death. Amen. So we look at the contrast and or the comparisons of these words, darkness and light. Spiritual darkness, that means without life. Without God, without hope, without the word, amen, which also is life, amen, life in the word, amen, the word of God. And so then you see that these people walk in darkness, they have seen a great light, amen. In other words, now they see light at the end of the tunnel. They see a ray of hope that is soon to come, amen. And the analogy that some have used is if you're in a totally dark place, amen, void of any speck of light, no candles, no light bulbs, no flashlights, and it's no daylight, no moonlight, there is complete darkness. Well, when you get any form or any speck of light, how powerful that light can be, no matter how small it is, but light will dispel, cast out darkness. Amen. Now let's look at it in the spiritual true sense of the difference that one that brings the word of God to a dark situation or to a dark atmosphere or a person that has simply the word of God in them. When you show up on the scene, amen. This is why the roaches run, the evil people run. They don't want to be around the light. Amen. Because if you have that word of God, which is the love of God, the spirit of God, and all the fruit of God dwelling in you. Amen. This is what you do to the atmosphere. When you come in, amen, darkness recognizes light and it begins to shield from light because it prefers darkness. Amen. So you had some that preferred darkness, and this was why God's destruction and his judgment was against them. He sent Isaiah, even starting out in the first part, first chapter of Isaiah, letting Isaiah know what to tell the people. Basically, you need to change your way because doom and destruction is headed your way. And if you would repent, if you would turn about and change your ways, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, turn from their wicked ways, seek my face, amen, then will I hear from heaven. I will forgive your sins and I will heal your land. God always gives a message of hope and a warning of pending justice, judgment, so that we can consider our ways and go about changing our ways. Amen. Reverse the course. Amen. And so these people, they were living beneath a shadow of death. They were living in darkness. But here comes news of the light, amen, that will soon come to them. Verse 3, thou hast multiplied the nations. Yes, he did. He expanded the nations. He grew the nations. He even engrafted, amen, and allowed just those to come that were seeking and that were willing to embrace the light. He said, you have multiplied the nation, God's people, and have increased their joy. And we take that little word not out. There's a misappropriation of that word. But you have multiplied the nation. You have increased their joy. They joy before thee according to the joy of the harvest. In other words, now he's giving examples. You know how it is, how people are joyful when they see the harvest finally come up and they're able to glean of a bountiful harvest. We are joyful as they are joyful and picking and putting in their baskets. Oh my gosh, look at this, a rich harvest. And then he gave another example of their joy. They are rejoicing as when soldiers or those who have defeated their foes, now it's time for them to divide and to distribute the spoil, the goods that they have captured from defeating or conquering the enemy. Amen. And so this is how the people's going to be, because ultimately Assyria was defeated by God. Amen. He even gave many prophecies, even through Isaiah, throughout the latter part, within the book of Isaiah, of how he was going to defeat all of the enemies. Amen. Of the children of Israel. He will judge Israel, but also just like a wand, he got a string on the enemy or the instruments or the armies that he will use to discipline Israel, amen, in order to bring them back to him, in order to get them to call upon the name of the Lord so that they can be saved out of their destruction and saved from the hands of their foes and their enemies, amen. God always leaves the door open to us. We are his people. We may get chastised, amen. We may get a bit beat up and bruised, amen. And he may suffer that to happen. But ultimately, he's only doing that so that he can preserve our soul, amen. That is the most important thing. We could take a few licks, amen. But he continues to enable us to tick, amen. He's not into trying to take us out. He's into trying to get us to wake up to the sense of our duties, consider our ways so that we can get back to him. Amen. Amen. Verse 4 says, for thou hast broken the yoke of his burden. In other words, the people's burden, the burden that they had, they was in distress. Amen. Certainly from after these armies conquering them, or this army conquering them. They were in distress. So God has broken the yoke of bondage. Amen. This yoke keeps you tied. It keeps you in bondage. It keeps you entangled. Amen. The staff of his shoulder. Amen. God has broken that. The staff that would beat and would discipline and would abuse his people. He has broken that. The rod of the oppressor. He has broken the rod of the impress. In other words, all of the work of the weapons that was used to oppress the people, to keep them subjected to their enemy, God is abolishing all of that, such as in the day as he did with Gideon, with the army of the Midianites. Amen. So God is telling them to remember how he helped Gideon defeat the Midianites. Well, he's going to do the same thing again. He's not going to just leave his people in the hands of their enemy. Verse 5 says, for every battle of the warrior is with confused noise. And so it is. There's a lot of confusion, chaos that is going on during the time of battle. And in the end, the garments are rolled in blood. Amen. Be it the dead soldiers, the wounded soldiers, their garments are rolled up. But should they have conquered, in the end, he says that their garments are going to be rolled up in blood, and then they're going to be burned as fuel for the fire. In other words, imagine your enemy and all of the dead soldiers. Amen. Dead soldiers will represent victory. Amen. And you ain't got no soldiers walking around looking you in the face, contending with you anymore. Then you can say that we have conquered. Amen. And so dead soldiers on the ground with the bloody clothes. And in other words, now you take up the evidence that you have conquered your enemy. Amen. And you throw it in the fire. In other words, it's done. It's complete. It's finished. Amen. Throw it in the fire and it now becomes like logs for fuel. Amen. As you sit back and just look at the smoke from the burned garments. Amen. Becoming ashes in the fire. It is done. It is finished. Amen. It's a new day. Amen. Without the enemy standing and tormenting you. Amen. As the Assyrians did at the gate of Judah. Amen. Surrounding them and was preparing. Amen. And was set to take over. Amen. Thank God. Thank God. Amen. In the end, we win. Amen. God's people win. So verse 6, it comes to us, for now unto us a child is born. So imagine from Isaiah, this writing of Isaiah, this prophecy of Isaiah, the time lapse that it would be to now the New Testament, Jesus, finally, this child, this wonderful child, Jesus, is to be born. He will come. Amen. For unto us a child is born. He will be born. Unto us a son is given. He's given unto us. Why? He's given through God himself as a gift. Amen. Of to save us. He came to save us. That is a theme of Isaiah, by the way. Salvation. Amen. Salvation comes, my God, through Emmanuel. He will be with us. So God is going to give us a son. The blessed hope is going to come in a child. Imagine that. The riches of our salvation. We will not always be in this situation. Judah will not always be in this situation. Israel, God's people, as a whole entire nation, will not always be in mourning. They will not always be hopeless and helpless, because a child is on the way. He's going to come, and the government, the responsibility of all nations will be upon his shoulder. Amen. He's the one that's going to be in rulership. Glory to God. And his name, this is what his government is going to represent. We know our government is what it's supposed to represent. It's supposed to represent integrity, right? Our government is supposed to represent truth. It is supposed to represent equality. It is supposed to represent pride, a balanced pride. It is supposed to represent justice. It is supposed to represent leadership and rulership. But even our government falters. but not God's government. His government is going to be called wonderful, bliss, great, perfect, obsolete, wonderful, glorious too. Amen. Wonderful. Counselor. Counselor mean his government is going to represent wisdom. It's going to be all wise. Amen. Wonderful counselor. Amen. There is no other counsel that is greater than God Almighty. His counsel, amen, is all knowing. Amen. And his government is going to be recognized as the mighty God. He's going to be the one that is in charge and heading and ruling this government, the mighty God. And we got all kind of words for the strength and the might, the wonders, or the wondrous of our God. His government is also going to be labeled as Everlasting Father. What is that? The love, the concern, the provision of a father unto his children. Amen. He will be ruling us. He will be ruling Israel as the wonderful Father, the Everlasting Father. Amen. To his kingdom there will be no end. And then lastly, the Prince of Peace. Peace. What a consoling word. Even in their time and in our time. Amen. There was chaos. There was corruption. There was death. There was destruction. And guess what? That sounds like the same times we are in right now. Huh? And be it truth that a lot of this is preceded or it comes from the government. Amen. Amen. Because it does not rule, or it is not ruling as it should rule. Amen. According to God and the word of God. God has a way for things to be. Amen. In our social world, in our political world. But what we are dealing with now is a lot of crises because the political is not right. Our leadership is faulty. Amen. And so therefore, we have unrest. We have peace, a lack of peace. We have helplessness and hopelessness. We have death and destruction, when all we need to do is hone back in, get centered again on what the will of the Lord is for our nation. Amen. In verse 7, last verse, it says, and of the increase of the greatness of the continuity of Jesus, God's government, and his peace, there will be no end. When he comes on the scene, amen, in increments of time, he will establish his government and the peace of his government worldwide, world without end. And there shall be no end upon the throne of David, because this was prophesied that the Messiah will come through the lineage of David, amen, and upon David's kingdom, amen. He was made king over Israel, amen. And what is he going to do? He's going to both order, and he's going to establish, and or he's going to uphold this kingdom, amen. This peaceful kingdom, this just and righteous kingdom, with judgment and with justice, from henceforth till tomorrow. No, from henceforth to the year 2030. No, amen. From henceforth, even forever. Amen. Prophesied, this is what it's going to be. Can you imagine the hope of these people who were without hope? Amen. Back in Isaiah's day, this Judah, amen, the nation of Judah. And we leave off with the zeal of the Lord of hosts the passion of the Lord of hosts, or the Lord of armies, will perform this. He's going to make it happen. He's going to bring it to pass. Amen. So this is our lesson as we break through our lesson. What is the takeaway point? Understanding that this justice and righteousness, this justice is the judgment of God. Amen. That has come upon Judah. Amen. But when we bring it to the sense all the way up today, we can zone in today that even we see the judgment of God, even in the land that we dwell in today. God is balancing the scales. Amen. He's balancing the scales even now. Amen. He's making things right for the wrong that has been done. He's calling into justice. He's calling into justice those things, those acts, those sins that he is against. Amen. This justice is through or being used, or the instrument that is being used to distribute this justice is the Assyrian army. Amen. The invasion of this army, the oppression of this army, and justice, even then as it is now. Remember, sin must be accounted for. I have to turn this off, or else it's gonna ring again, y'all. All sin must be accounted for, and whether justice be delayed is not going to be denied, because God would be untrue to his word if he was not going to hold his people accountable. But even in the process of accountability, we thank God for Jesus. Amen. Thank God that Jesus has come. He has come. Since Isaiah wrote the book of Isaiah, he has come. He came in the New Testament, and he's coming back. Amen. He came, he lived, he died, he resurrected and got off of the cross, got up out of the grave. He went back to heaven, but he's coming again. Amen. And so, just like these people of Judah, we have time to get ourselves ready, amen, for his return. Amen. Righteousness. We thank God that God is soon going to make things right once again. Amen. Because Jesus is coming back and he's going to claim his kingdom worldwide. Amen. And he is going to reign. But we thank God for the good news that comes out of this lesson, that it doesn't just leave us in pending doom. It doesn't just show us the chaos and the confusion, but it also shows us the hope that we can appreciate through the prophecy, the coming of Jesus Christ, the King. Amen. The coming King. Amen. And so with this, how can we apply this to this upcoming holiday, Christmas? Amen. Christmas. How do we see Christ in this lesson? Hope. Amen. We see him as a gift of hope that is given to us by God, that is prophesied in this lesson. A child is going to be born. Amen. And it's going to be a son that is given. That is Jesus. Amen. And it is for this reason, the true reason, that we should celebrate Christmas. Christmas is all about Christ. There will be no Christmas. There will be no gifts. There will be no celebrating. There will be no joy. There will be no merriness had not Jesus set the stage in his word. Amen. Had he not come on the scene, the world would be dead. Amen. We wouldn't even be here. Amen. Had not Jesus come to save the world. Amen. Had he not come to save the world, it would have been gloom, doom, death, destruction, done. We wouldn't be here. So we must remember this as we go about our shopping, as we brainstorm what gifts to buy our loved ones, our friends, as we spend and splurge. Let us not forget that if it was not for Jesus, Christmas, in the commercial sense, wouldn't even be a thing. Amen? It wouldn't even be. So we thank God for his gift. Amen? For God so loved us, the world, that he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe on him, would accept him, amen, would not perish, but they would have everlasting life. Amen, 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 amen. That's it. That's it. That is our lesson. Amen. Justice and righteousness. Amen. In the perspective under Christian's endeavor. Amen. You may have something else to add, or you may want to extract something from the lesson. You do that. Amen. And if you feel free to want to leave us a comment of how this lesson prayerfully has blessed you and has enlightened you in some kind of way, then we oblige you to go on ahead and leave us a comment. If you're not already a subscriber, then we welcome you to become a subscriber, and we welcome you to be a participator. Amen. And also a thumbs up, evangelist of the word. Yes, you can evangelize the word by pushing the thumbs up, because as you push the thumbs up, you're actually pushing the gospel, amen, one soul further. Someone else will be able to hear this blessed message that you have heard, amen. So don't be selfish, amen. It's not just about you hearing the message. And certainly it's not about you doing me a favor. It is about you being a pusher and an evangelist, a carrier of the gospel. And you can do it right in your seat, pushing the thumbs up button, amen, and let YouTube know through their algorithm that this is a message that is liked, amen, and it wants to be shared, amen. And so certainly, again, I encourage you to share the word, push the share button, share the message with someone else that may not be able to be a part of a Sunday school message, or someone that is confined in some kind of way and cannot get to the word. Give them hope. Amen. And let them know that Jesus is on the scene. He was prophesied in our lesson, but he is on the scene. His spirit dwells in the earth. Amen. Hear ye him. And so I'm Minister Coleman, and I want to thank you again for joining me on this Christian's Endeavor YouTube station. I implore you to have the best and the greatest Christmas holiday with family and friends. Enjoy your gifts, but remember the giver. Amen. Jesus Christ. And certainly prepare for your upcoming blessed and marvelous and all the other attributes that Jesus will have you to have 2022, because we're headed there. Amen. And I know I'm going to see you on the other side. Be blessed. Thank you again for joining me.